I wrote 2 years ago a book of fairy tales, Grimm-like fairy tales, which was, I felt, it was time to regress a little bit, and there are moral fairy tales, there are 5 of them. And they basically tell certain themes which derail executives. The first one is the famous statement from above the Temple of Apollo, know thyself. So many executives have no idea what their strengths and weaknesses are. That's one fairy tale. The second one is that some executives, of course not in Ireland, because of their power positions, start to suffer from another interesting Greek word called hubris, excessive pride. It gets to their head. They start to surround themselves in an echo chamber of people who tell them what they want to hear. Other serious problem. The third one is that I am most surprised how many executives don't get the best out of their people. They really get the worst out of their people, which is pretty stupid because leadership is trying to bring people to places they didn't expect to be. The next one is particularly top executive teams are unnatural acts. They don't function very well. And so they spend millions of dollars on IT systems, but they have a top executive team that makes faulty decisions because of too much covert and overt conflict. And finally, many organizations have this kind of gulag atmosphere. So my mission in life has always been how to create organizations where people feel at their best. And the acid test to me is always, do you want your children, your friends to work in this organization? That if they say yes, fantastic, then I believe them. No. No. Because every organization is different. It's like a Rorschach test. I go into an organization and interview people and try to find out about undiscussables. But I mean, in a way, it's the challenge of its leadership to present things very simple. That can people understand. And it becomes too messy. And of course, when you have present type of organization with virtual teams and matrix structures and also the whole digital wave, it looks very complex, but still you can, set up simple rules. And I'm a great believer in that. I think creating complexity is very often a way of hiding what's really going on. I mean, I'm thinking about, for example, in the last century, you had at that time the most famous executive was Jack Welch. And he set up a simple rule about, in your business, if you're not number one or number two, get out. Yeah, pretty simple. I mean, don't make it too messy. Simple rules. I have been the apostle of group coaching as a way of changing organizations. And we of course have now all different means of communicating with Skype, Zoom, FaceTime, and things like that. But I'm a strong believer if you have virtual teams, which can be extremely creative, but also have the potential for paranoia, you have to make an investment up front. You cannot email a smile or a handshake. And I've worked with quite famous companies, which are quite listed in Fortune as some more of the most team-oriented organization, but make an investment. And really try to create complementary teams. Leadership is really teamwork. I keep on saying that. But again, when you ask about questions, about people ask me, what is great leadership? It's like, I always say, like there is no baby without a mother. There's no leader without a context. And to be the managing partner of McKinsey, who I was one of my students actually, you need a different leadership style than running a steel mill in the Caucasus. So you have to be context specific, and depending on power distance and all those kinds of things. I do a lot of work in Asia, so it's in different ways of communicating and being able to read the subtle signals. What you see is not what you get. And so I use what's called the clinical paradigm, maybe the psychodynamic systemic orientation, that you have to be aware of the snakes under the carpet. And the kind of defensive structures organizations also build up. Otherwise, you can have the most rational, simplistic solutions, but you don't go anywhere. You will be sabotaged. Now, I was the director, I actually founded our leadership center, which became one of the largest in the world. And I used to be the pathologist of organizations, meaning I looked at what can go wrong. But after Dean gave me this assignment, I have to look at how to make good people even better. Now, for leadership development, the first place, of course, is self-assessment. I talked about knowing your strengths and weaknesses. I developed personally, actually, I don't like it very much. I had to go into psychometrics, a whole battery of tests, 360. So people who go through my programs, they get actually 720, because I've met many people who say my boss is an idiot, my colleagues are idiots, my direct reports are idiots. But when your grown-up daughter tells Pa, you're an idiot, that might create a tipping point, they start to think. So the first place is self-assessment really is. Now when I start, I run a CEO seminar once a year, and people used to tell me how glorious they are, you know, God's gift to mankind. Then I would enter the organization and they're Genghis Khan. So what people say they do and they really do, you have to be quite cynical about it. And so for the coaches who have little time, because coaching is very expensive, it's not mass production, not like now I'm going to give a speech for a large number of people, they need some startup material, and 720s, I sometimes call it, is very useful. The second is to give young people P&L responsibility, skin in the game. That's the way they learn. And they make mistakes, of course, that's the way they learn. And so people should give them that opportunity, the organizations. The third one is the element of imprinting, the element of shadowing, role modeling. You learn a lot from good bosses, but you can also learn from bad bosses. But I think many executives don't realize the first job their younger people have is like Conrad Lorenz imprinting. And finally, you can talk about coaching. And coaching used to be, of course, a remedial thing. You said you need a coach because you're a lemon, maybe it's your last hooray. But nowadays, it's a trite statement, but it's really lonely at the top in many ways. And you need somebody who's outside the system. You can do some, as a sparring partner. And so those things are important in development of people. Now, the 360s are also useful, I found, in teasing out sometimes very seductive, somewhat psychopathic individuals, because they're very good in managing upward. So people, the bosses, don't realize what kind of they have, and HR might not realize it, but the people below experience it, how they take credit for everything. Now they're ruthless, wanting to win and things like that. And those people you have to take out of the organization because they create a toxic atmosphere. So basically what I always say, I try to create authentic organizations, meaning organizations where people feel alive.